table of the Lord at the table. Good morning and welcome to worship at Mount Hope United Church of Christ. We are glad that you are here. I want to say thank you to those of you who have commented and let us know that you are here building a community with us this morning. There are a few announcements that I would like to share with you. First, if you have been unable to make a comment, you've been able to see the comments but I'm unable to make one on our Facebook Live feed. You may want to scroll down at the bottom where your icons are or your emojis, the little faces or the hearts or the care sign, and scroll, just move your finger over them and swipe them to the right. You'll see a comment bar that is right beside them, and it's possible that that has gotten off center and you cannot see where to make the comments. I know that sounds simple, and it might be that simple. It might be more complicated, but it'll be a good thing to try this morning, and let me know if that works. Secondly, I want to remind the youth ages 6th grade through 12th grade that there will be a youth meeting today on Zoom tonight at 5 o'clock p.m. Our Bible study, this one is called God Unbound. It's a study in Galatians. Will be Wednesday at 6 o'clock p.m. on Zoom. Choir practice is meeting this week. I am right about that, Joe, right? All right. Wednesday at 7:30 on Zoom. And if you are unsure of how to get onto the Zoom pages or which one to get onto, the church does have two assigned Zoom pages. You just go to our website. You will see the Zoom that is for Bible study and the Zoom that is for choir practice and meetings. So we've tried to make that where it will be simple for everyone. Again, if you try to practice maybe during the day between 9 and 1, when Stacy is here and you cannot find what you're looking for, do not hesitate to give the office a call and Stacy can help walk you through that. And lastly, our volunteer-based ministry for delivering food to the school-aged children and families is beginning soon, and we do still need volunteers. If you are able to help between the hours of roughly 10:45 and 1:15 each day, Monday through Friday, please let us know. You can call Aiken or you can call the church and leave a message for her here and let us know of your availability, which days would work for you. If I have missed any announcements that you would like to highlight, please make a comment and let us know what they are. We will highlight them. And at any given time during this live worship, please make sure that if you have a prayer on your heart or a concern, a joy, if there's been a birth in your family or a wedding or a death, if there's been anything that has happened in your family that you normally would share with the life of this congregation, we hope that you will share it with us now. For that is part of what we are doing during these COVID times. You may have seen this in print of something that the church has sent out, but we are being safe, we are being connected, and we are being rooted in God's love. So as we stay connected, it's important to hear what is going on in your life. Joan and Aiken will bring us some more music, and then we will join together in prayer, spoken prayer, so please make every effort to put your comments down so that we might include your specific prayers in our prayer time today. One other announcement, Make a Difference Day, the day where we pack lunches and bags of food for Alamance Plaza residents, will be September the 19th, and donations for that are needed. There is a sign-up genius that is being created for you to be able to sign up for the things that are needed, since we don't have that common bulletin board here in the hallway at the church. If you are great with things like that, wonderful. When the link goes out this week in the newsletter, you'll be able to click right on it and sign right up. If that's not something that you feel comfortable doing, or you get a paper copy only of the newsletter and would like some assistance, please feel free again to call the office, and we will help you here through the church office be connected with the things that are needed. We'll let you know what those are and the times in which they need to be delivered. We do have mainly food donations, but we also have bags of dirt that are needed, not for the bagged lunches, but for the community garden that we are joining together with Alamance Plaza to create. So a few needs there combined in one, and that will all be part of our Make a Difference Day on the 19th. What joys and concerns would you share with the life of this congregation today?
I have a couple of prayer requests. Becky's friend, Bobby and Vicky, are recovering from COVID. And Brittany's grandmother, Gladys, who is getting a pacemaker placed tomorrow. And as always, her Pawpaw Garland.
All right.
Linda and Mary May.
Fred Turner's family. Fred passed away this week and is the brother of Jim Turner. So we want to hold Jim and all of his family, especially his mother Clara, in our prayers. They also had a couple of other prayer requests, Dom Lagana and Marshall Mann. We want to surround Connie Blakesley and her parents in our prayers as they undergo some time together this weekend. Gordon Howell, Betty Greeson, our student and family ministry, Adelita Swaim, Lloyd and Sylvia, Mandy and Beezer, Shirley, Clapp, Chelsea, Jessica, Wesley, Linda and Larry, Jeff, Helen, Bob and Cindy, Brian Smith, Lee Shores. We certainly remember today all of those who have been affected by the natural disasters, the fires, the floods, the hurricanes, and all of those who continue to be overtaken by grief and by rage in the streets in other states, as well as our own, through riots and great concerns. Anyone else? Let us go to God in a spirit of prayer. Gracious and holy God, today we read the story of Moses, not the small Moses that was in the basket floating in the reeds by the river, but the grown-up Moses, who was wandering through the wilderness trying to figure out what to do. And we know, O God, that you heard the footsteps of the wandering Moses. We know, O God, that you knew his heart. We know, O God, that you were just waiting for him to say, yes, I will go through the wilderness to the mountain of God and see that bush burning, calling my name. It is possible, O Lord, that all of us have a burning bush waiting for us to find it, a burning bush calling our name. So today, O God, we pray for the courage to go where it is we need to go to find it. We ask prayers this day for those who are struggling with physical illness, mental illness, financial concerns, emotional isolation, those who are wanting answers and needing results. We pray for Jim and Clara, Kathy, and all of their family. We lift up to you Connie and her parents, Dom and Marshall and Gordon and Betty, our student family ministry, Adelita, Lloyd and Sylvia, Mandy and Beezer, Shirley, Chelsea, Jessica, Cheryl, Wesley, Linda and Larry, Jeff, Helen, Bob and Cindy, Brian and Lee, those who have been affected by flame and flood, those who are being overtaken and have only found the way of rioting to express what it is that they are trying to say. Lord, give them another language. Be with Bobby and Vicky and Papa Garland and Gladys. Lord God, wrap all of them up in your mercy, that they might know of your grace, that they might live into your courage, and they might be at peace with your love. And now hear the prayer of your people as we pray the prayer our brother Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today comes from the second book of the Old Testament, Exodus, 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 15. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burning up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings. And I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Pizzites, Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people up out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this very mountain. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent to me to you, and they ask me, what is God's name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be. Last week we left Moses in the adopted care of Pharaoh's daughter. Today we find him all grown up, tending to the sheep of his father-in-law Jethro in Midian, the middle of nowhere. Hear the first two verses again. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Moses was taking care of the flock for his father-in-law Jethro, Midian's priest. I am not sure if Moses ever had any dreams of what he hoped to be growing up in Pharaoh's palace, but my guess is tending his father-in-law's flock hadn't come to the top of his list. After reading the events of chapter 2, we learn that Moses kills a man who was attacking his people, and Pharaoh found out about it, came after him, and sent Moses running to the middle of nowhere, where no one would know his name. In keeping with the Cheers theme, not everyone likes to go where everybody knows their name. Sometimes hiding is the mission, and Moses was hiding in Midian. Things moved pretty fast. Moses did a good deed, met her father, got married, and now he is tending his sheep in the middle of nowhere, Midian. A head-spinning chapter in his life, Midian brought some time for meditation, for sorting it all out to decide his next steps. Moses was a shepherd in this chapter. A stinky, smelly, unappreciated job tending someone else's flock. He was just keeping it between the lines. He was in the middle between where he had been and where he was going. He was maintaining. He had a wife and a child. He was keeping the status quo, holding down a job, going through the routine, keeping it between the lines. We can possibly relate to where Moses is in the middle of things. Aren't we in the middle? 6 feet apart from all the people we want to be with? Aren't we just on the outskirts of being able to give those we long for a great big hug? School-aged children are in between traditional ways of school and virtual school. Many families are towing the thin line of a delicate balancing act, deciding how to work and take care of the children at home during the day while not letting financial debt build up too high, that is. Our nation, our world knows what it is to be on the edge in the middle of a pandemic, feeling far away from anything familiar and the middle of absolute nowhere. How does one move through Midian? The second part of verse 1 says, Moses led his flock out to the other side of the wilderness. He led his flock beyond the wilderness. To come to the other side of something means you first have to go through it. To come to the other side of something means that you first must have had the courage to step toe-to-toe to the line of where it started. Coming through to the other side of something means that you wandered through it and came to the other side. There is no way around the wilderness. It is a life station that cannot be bypassed. Had this very short board book when my children were little called I'm Going on a Bear Hunt. And the family going on this bear hunt, you remember that book? The family going on a bear hunt would get to the tall, wavy grass, and you could see the mother and father putting the smallest children on their around their necks, carrying them on their shoulders, and passing through whatever it was, the thick mud, the rain, the water, whatever it was, they had to pass through it. And it would say, you can't go over it. You can't go under it. You got to go through it. This was one of those life stations that could not be bypassed. You cannot go over it. You cannot go under it. You have to go through it. I suppose there is another way. Moses could have come up to the wilderness and decided not to go through it, around it, over it, or under it at all, promising to never know what was on the other side. Could have ignored it, allowed the wilderness to be his limit, to be as far as he could go, the line in the sand that dared him to cross over it, promising pain and comfort if he did. So today I wonder what compelled Moses to go into the wilderness in the first place. So maybe Moses had been through so much that he was completely glassed over, so overwhelmed with life and all that had just happened in his, that he didn't realize where he was going. Maybe he got into the wilderness by accident, just meandering behind the sheep when he woke up out of a stupor. And there he was, too far in to know how to not keep going. Or maybe Moses went through the wilderness because he felt he didn't deserve any good that life had to offer him. Maybe he was down on himself. Self-confidence tanked. Moses may have entered the wilderness because he had given up on life. Could it be possible that Moses allowed himself to step into the wilderness because he wanted to see what God had for him? That he was tired of trying to go it alone and he was ready to surrender to God's power in his life. Chapter 2 and chapter 3 tell us a great deal about Moses and his life, but it doesn't give us the answer to why. Why he decided to journey through the wilderness. What we do know is that the wilderness has beckoned many. The wilderness, if you can call it that, is where Joseph found himself before he ended up in the high court of Egypt. Being down in the middle of a well, sold by your brothers into slavery, is indeed a wilderness of life. We know that David went running from those who sought for his life, especially for the soon-to-be King Saul. And we know that David was in a wilderness. We know that a lot of people in our scriptures have chosen to go into the wilderness. Jesus was driven into the wilderness. We assume that he knew he was going, that he wanted to go, because it was there that he knew he not only would be tested and proofed for the job that he was called to do in his ministry, but it was there while he waited in the wilderness, that he would come face to face with God, who gave him his strength and his courage, and reminded him that he had been named and claimed by the one who had created him. What we do know about the wilderness is that if we dare to ever pass through it like Moses did, there is usually something far greater than our imagination can conjure up, waiting on the other side. Many people in Scripture went into the wilderness to make their sacrifices. They went into the wilderness to have some space in which to worship and in which to pray and in which to bring their greatest offerings. So there was something of a sanctuary that happened, at least in the edges of the wilderness. But what we know about Moses is that while he was just keeping it between the lines, something beckoned him beyond where he had ever been before. He allowed his wandering feet to go in that direction. And when he got there, it was then that he found his direction. It was then that he found God. It was then that he heard God's call on his life. And so I'll ask, are we willing to go through the wilderness to get to the other side? For the scriptures tell us that when we can get through to the other side of the wilderness, it is there that we will find the mountain of God. Wherever you are on life's journey, whatever wilderness you find yourself standing toe to toe with today, know that there is a mountain of God on the other side of it. And that God will not leave you nor forsake you, but God will have a burning bush waiting to call your name. In the name of our God, who creates us, redeems us, and hopes always for our courage to step into the hard places of life, to struggle just a little bit, so that we can see what God has for us. Amen. As we move through this world that sometimes gives us much to think about, as we struggle these days in watching the news and how to help those who are in destruction, how to help those who need our help, how to share the resources that we've been given and give to those who have none. When we struggle and when we dare to think deep enough about how we can interject, how we can share in a situation, how we can come together as the community of Christ, God will meet us there and will show us the way. I hope this week that you will find a way to share your resources, that you will find a way to either share with the church through bailing them in or contributing online or going through your bank's institution to set up something there through online banking. Hope that you'll take a moment to talk to your neighbor and make sure that they are okay. Reaching out to a family member that you know often struggles that might need a little extra assistance. Financial assistance is great, but emotional and physical support is also important. What is it that you have to give? If you met God at the burning bush after going through the wilderness, how would God ask you to be with God's people? give today, not because you have to, but because you must, because you are compelled to share what you have with those who need it most. I pray for you as a giver. I pray for the ones who are receiving these gifts, that together we might form the body of Christ. One member strengthens the whole body of the church. Amen.
God, my feet while I'm
And now as you go, know this, that you did not come to Midian alone. You do not travel through Midian alone, and you will not come to the other side of the wilderness of Midian alone. For there is a burning bush burning but not being consumed that waits for you to hear your name. Go in the peace of Christ. With all of the goodness, with all of the compassion, and all of the love that God has for each of you. And I'll go out into the world and share it, one person at a time, that all may know of God's love for them.